Was charming music written by Eugene Ormandy. I knew that he was a child prodigy, but I figured it was as a musician. I didn't even know he wrote music. And our pianist, Rodney Sauer, who will be playing at the Kansas Silent Film Festival this weekend in Topeka. What was going through your mind as you played that? It sounded a little bit flirtatious.
Yeah, it's a little piece called Charming Episode from 1928. It's very much like a song. You could imagine writing lyrics to it. It's got a verse, it's got a chorus. So he was paying attention to that. At the time, he had actually come, as you mentioned, he was a prodigy violinist. He came to do a tour in America, and while he was on the crossing, his producer went bankrupt and disappeared. And so he arrived on the wharves of New York not speaking any English, and was found by somebody who introduced him to Erno Rappé, who was also from the same country, but was the very successful conductor of the Capitol Theater Orchestra, which was a movie theater orchestra in New York, and took Eugene Ormandy on, and he came on as a violinist and worked his way up to be an assistant conductor, and then when the talkies came in, he had a natural bridge to get into conducting, and that's where we all know him from, is all of those excellent interpretations of the big symphonies. But he got his start in movie theaters.
Fascinating. And that was called Charming Episode.
Charming Episode from 1928. Yes, and I'm sure he just sort of, you know, had this idea and wrote it down. And there was a huge market for music for movies. It was almost insatiable. Anyone who wrote music could get things out there. I liked it. I had never heard of him as a composer. I'm not sure he would have told you he was a composer. He might have forgotten it too. But it was in an archive, and I thought, oh, that'll be beautiful. And I use it as the love theme for Safety Last, which is the movie we're showing tonight to finish the program. It's Harold Lloyd. It's a very well-known comedy, and rightly so. It is incredibly entertaining. So come out to the White Concert Hall tonight, and you'll get a whole evening, actually, of Harold Lloyd showing some of his early short comedies and then getting into this as the feature film.
All right. Now, what did the Ridin' Kid describe? Was it horseback?
Well, none of these pieces were written specifically for any particular movie. Oh. The idea was you would buy a bunch of music and make a library, and then when a movie came, you had sometimes in a matter of a couple days to put your score together. So the idea was to have a library that you're somewhat familiar with, and you would just go pull pieces for each scene. So the Ridin' Kid was written by Frederick Stahlberg. It was part of a suite about, you know, music on the ranch. And so if you were doing a Western, you might pull out the Ridin' Kid. And it's a very lively piece. We often use it as an overture because we have a lot of fun playing it. But it also could be used, as you said, for a horse chase across the mesas, chasing down the wrestlers. There were a lot of Westerns that came out in the silent era, and they all needed music like that.
So what can we hear next? What else will you be playing tonight?
Well, I'm also going to be playing tomorrow night for an unusual Charlie Chaplin film in that Charlie Chaplin doesn't actually appear in it. He'd been making a series of incredibly successful comedies, but he'd always wanted to make a drama, and so he does not appear in the film, but he wrote and directed the film. Edna Purviance, who was his longtime leading lady, is the star of the film. It's called A Woman of Paris, and the piece I'm going to play, again, it was not written for that film, but I chose it to play during the film. It's called Silent Sorrows, by a composer named Gaston Bourque, who was very prolific. What I was looking for in this film, there's a scene where these two lovers have been separated for over a year, and she opens the door and walks in, and there he is. And what I wanted was a piece that I could use at the beginning that in only a few notes the audience might remember, so that I could use it at that scene as well, and it would bring back the emotions, because that's exactly what happens to them. They suddenly remember, oh, that's right, we had a thing, didn't we? And they've both forgotten it, kind of. But these things never go away, especially not in a film. So this is called Silent Sorrows. It has a little introduction, and then you'll hear this little three-note motif. And that's what I'm hoping people will remember when they see the film.
The music of Gaston Bourque, Silent Sorrows. That was played by Rodney Sauer, who's one of the pianists, one of the musicians, to play live music to accompany the Kansas Silent Film Festival this weekend in Topeka. So you do prepare the music ahead of time. I guess I had an image in my mind of a pianist who would just watch the screen and just kind of improvise things.
That is very much a thing, yes. No, there are really three ways to compose scores for films. Improvising, which you're referring to there, where I'm just watching the film and I'm making stuff up and reacting the same as the audience is. And I have occasionally played for movies I've never seen before, which is always a bit of a thrill. But you have a memory of some pieces in your head that you'll go to when you need them, or you're just making stuff up, and that's great fun. So improvisation. Composition, which is what's mostly done nowadays, where you actually write everything down note by note, phrase by phrase, instrument by instrument, and then you record it. But there's a third kind of film scoring, which is compilation. And that was mostly what was done, especially for orchestras back in the silent era, where you would pick music for each scene, but you wouldn't write or arrange anything. It was all in your library. And so that's what I'm trying to recreate with my group, the Mont Alto Motion Picture Orchestra. And we are still together. It's just that it did not work out this weekend. So we'll hopefully be back next year and play all five of us here. And if you look on the KNU website, you'll find recordings of us in the past. It is rather weird to try to play these on solo piano when I hear them in my head played by violins and cellos and clarinet.
I bet. Rodney Sauer, the pianist, he lives in Louisville, Colorado, and he's appeared at the Kansas Silent Film Festival lots of time since the third event, and this is the 26th year. Rodney manages the Mount Alto Motion Picture Orchestra. So this year, Rodney's going solo for some of the things here in Topeka. And before we switch to another pianist, Ben Modell, Marvin Falwell is going to be playing the organ. He's amazing, and that organ in the space is amazing. I'm looking forward to that.
Yes, Ben Modell is actually also going to play organ.
Oh, really?
Yes,
he's a very talented organ player.
Yeah, both piano and organ, but just not at the same time.
Okay, Ben, why don't you?
Because one's on the other side
Rodney,
of the stage. It's a sprint I can't do.
No. Why don't you two switch places? Let's.
Right.
Okay, while Ben's getting situated, Ben Modell is one of the nation's leading silent film accompanists, performing on both piano and theater organ. Over the past 35 years, he has created and performed hundreds of live scores for silent films. He's one of the few exponents of this craft who is working at it full-time, something that has not happened since about 1930. Mm-hmm. Ben is a resident film accompanist at the Museum of Modern Art in New York City and at the Library of Congress's Packard Campus Theater. He's a regular accompanist at Classic Films Festival across the United States and internationally. And he plays at colleges, museums, and historic theaters. He's the producer and co-founder of the Silent Clowns film series, which is now in its 20th season in New York City. Ben Modell, welcome to Kansas. Thanks for coming to the Kansas Silent Film Festival.
Oh, glad to be here, Cordelia. Thanks for having me on. Glad to be back on KPR.
Good.
Yeah.
What are you going to play for us?
Like Rodney was mentioning, the way I accompany films is almost entirely improvised, so I often don't know. What I thought I might play, if I can play it correctly, is a piece of music I wrote in March of 2020, the week just before the shutdown. I watched, in a 48-hour period, every single gig I had canceled because of the COVID shutdown, and I put together the tech which I had already had for a live streamed silent film show that would be live accompanied on and presented on YouTube, which was called the Silent Comedy Watch Party. And we're having our third anniversary show next month, but I wanted to come up with a theme song so that when people would tune in, there would always be the same music. And let's see if I can play any of it. Thank you. Thank you. And it was doing this show. We did it every single week on Sundays at 3:00 on YouTube. And we found we would hear from people all over the planet who now had nowhere to go and who needed some relief and needed the laughs. And so my friend Steve Massa and I bring him in virtually through some software that's kind of like having a TV control room on your laptop called program called Mimo Live. We bring Steve in and he introduces the film and I accompany them live. So it's all really happening, but people really needed relief from the stress of what was happening and what was changing every week. And it became appointment television, if I may use that expression. And I will probably find this at the Kansas Silent Film Festival as I did last year. Our beautiful logo, designed by Marlene Weissman, appears on people's tote bags and T-shirts and what have you, and people will show up wearing these things, and They'll wave. I open the show and I wave with one hand to the camera. And people, I've heard, will wave back at their computers. And sometimes when I get up on a stage, now that we're doing it in-person shows, people will wave at me. But it was a connection that we all had together. And we're still doing the shows just on a monthly basis now.
Before we talk to Laura Gabrielle about her new book about Marion Davies, is there anything you're playing to accompany a Marion Davies film this weekend?
Well, I'm glad you asked. Funny, yes, I am accompanying on pipe organ. I'll be using the pipe organ to accompany a film called Little Old New York, 1923 picture starring Marion Davies. And it's a film that I released on home video on my DVD label Under Crank Productions, and it's also been licensed to Turner Classic Movies. So I'll be accompanying Little Old New York. And that's something that was a project that was funded by fans through Kickstarter, a Kickstarter run by my friend Edward LaRusso, and we worked together, and I released it on DVD. I won't be playing anything from that right now, but there is a piece, a main theme from it that was composed, actually commissioned by Hearst from Victor Herbert. So I'll use that later. But I can come up with something else if we have time for more music, and if not, I will be playing for Little Old New York tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
You don't want to play it now?
I don't know how to play it.
Oh. not by
heart. I didn't rehearse
I see.
It.
Oh, okay.
And I'm...
So you've got to go to
film
school.
So it's much easier for me to make up music than it is to play established music. I could, you know, it's just much easier. I learned my craft from a man named Lee Irwin, who was a movie organist in the 1920s. And when I started playing for films, when I was in college, I met whoever I could who was still doing it in New York. And I met Lee Irwin and also a guy named William Perry. And if you ever saw silent movies on public television in the 1970s, those were a series called The Silent Years, produced by Paul Killiam, and they all had scores by Bill Perry, who is 92 and he's still composing. I interviewed him for my silent film music podcast last year, and he has some amazing stories. So it's just easier for me to improvise.
Sure.
Lee was an improviser, and I can put my hands on the piano and something will come out of it.
Play an original for us.
Okay, sure. Thank you.
Wow.
Thank
Ben
you.
Modell, what was that, Ben?
I'm sorry?
Is there a title?
That was...
Impromptu.
I don't know. I just made that up.
Oh,
I put my
no.
hands on
Impromptu.
The keys. And, yeah. I have no I don't know.
You're amazing.
We'll just call it...
improvisation.
I have no idea. I have no idea. I tried to squeeze as many different kinds of moods as I could into a few minutes.
That's the playing of Ben Modell. He's from New York City and one of the few people in the world who does this full time. He plays for silent films. Thank you, Ben.
Yeah, my pleasure. Thanks.
One of the special guests this weekend at the Kansas Silent Film Festival is Laura Gabrielle. She's a film writer and researcher whose work on Marion Davies has been featured in the Wall Street Journal, the San Francisco Chronicle, Airmail, and on PBS's American Experience. Her biography, Captain of Her Soul, The Life of Marion Davies, was named one of the Alta Journal's top books to read this past fall, and it was included in Leonard Maltin's list of 5 new and notable books. She's spoken about Davies at film festivals and retrospectives worldwide and has served as a consultant on her life and legacy for books, dissertations, and film projects. And Gabrielle is from Oakland, California. Welcome to KPR, Laura.
Thank you so much for having me. It's nice to be here.
Well, tell us all about Marion Davies for those who don't know who she is.
That's a big question, all about Marion Davies. Well, Marion Davies was a silent film actress and a sound film actress as well. But most of her work was in silent films. And she is probably best known today as, one, the romantic partner of William Randolph Hearst, the publishing tycoon from the early part of the 20th century. And also people think that she is represented in the character of Susan Alexander in the movie Citizen Kane, which is... It is difficult because that's a movie she was never in, and it's a movie that's been misunderstood by a lot of people. So in my work on Marion Davies, I try to bring Marion Davies into the light in her own right as a woman who was, as the title of my book says, captain of her soul. She made all her own decisions. She had agency. She negotiated her own contracts. She was really her own woman, and I wanted to give her voice back to her.
Great. So you've written a book.
Yes.
And it's, tell us the name of the book again.
Captain of Her Soul, The
Yes.
Life of Marion Davies.
Wow.
Yes.
Did you, I bet you interviewed lots of people.
I did. I was lucky in some ways because Marion died in 1961. So a lot of the people that she knew well in her life have died. But there are some people, some really important people who are still alive, who knew her well. One of those people is named Stanley Flink. He helped her do her autobiographical tapes, and he was also he was a correspondent for Life magazine, and he was also the only member of the press witness to the day of Hearst's death, which was very intense. So he could tell me firsthand these really important moments in Marion Davies' life that he witnessed, and he's going to be 99 in March.
Oh, wow.
So, and he's still around and still very sharp.
Now, for those only able to go to a portion of the festival, when do you... Now, I assume you're going to present the film and give some interesting background before the film?
Yes, I'm going to be presenting Little Old New York tomorrow. And I'm also going to be giving the cinema dinner talk on Saturday night.
Now, is there a cost or a sign-up for that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah, that's a $40 ticket fee. And there are some tickets that can be purchased at the White Concert Hall. We had some left, so they are available. And Laura will be our keynote speaker.
Wow.
For that evening. So
that's great. Is this your first time here?
This is my first time in Kansas. Yes.
Oh my! What do you think?
I love it. I'm having so much fun so far.
Do you kind of like the cold? It must be colder here than you're used to.
Yeah. Somebody asked me yesterday. Oh, is it really cold? And I was expecting it to be colder. Actually, I sort of likened it to stepping into a refrigerator.
It's kind of an unusual cold snap. I hope it's the last one of the year.
Yes.
Well, Bill Schaefer, thank you for coming.
You're welcome.
What are you doing for this year's festival? Are you presenting?
I do my usual, you know, directing role where we, you know, kind of organize our chaos that is the Kansas Silent Film Festival. But actually, I will be introducing a film in the morning, on Saturday morning, It is called The Lost City of Cecil B. DeMille. It is a documentary about the artifacts that they found connected with the Ten Commandments, the original film that he made in 1923, and will be running it on Saturday night. So this is just a documentary about how they found all these artifacts and set pieces and props and things like that out in the California desert, and spent about 30 years trying to get them into a museum or some place where, you know, they could be appreciated. And they managed to do it, but it took a long time. So it's an interesting story. And the documentary was so much fun to watch that I thought, we need to run this. We need to run this before we show that film. So that's why we're doing it Saturday morning, and then they're doing the Ten Commandments that night. So it'll be fun.
Mm-hmm. What sets this year's festival apart from the rest?
Almost everything this year is 1923 vintage, because we're in 2023. We're 100 years away from that particular period. So we decided to try to put all of our eggs in one basket and show as many films from that era as we could. Rodney mentioned to me the other day that we just ran The Hunchback of Notre Dame last year. That particular film is also from 1923, so we didn't want to rerun it this year. So we had to skip a few, but we're keeping it pretty much all 1923 era. So
the silent film era, the start of what we would consider movies that are sort of filmed in the modern vocabulary of film starts around 1920, and there are a lot of movies from earlier that are very good, but they take a little bit. They're a little harder to get into sometimes unless you're studying them, because of how they're put together. And that's an overgeneralization, but some of them can be a little. They seem flighty. The script is not particularly stuck to. There's a lot of stuff going around. By 1923, most of the movies we're showing feel very modern. And then the talkies really started in 1927. They took till about 1930 till all of the movies were sound. So there's about a 5-year period there that are the classic silent films. Most of the ones you see are from 1923 through about 1928 or 29. And so this is a good year for movies. And if they keep doing this, the movies will keep getting more and more
more
modern. Things changed a lot very fast in the silent era. You can watch a film if you've seen a bunch, and you can usually spot it within 2 or 3 years of when was this film made. Or you'll see a film that was made in 1925, and you'll say, boy, that looks like it was filmed in 1918. And people, you know, who are into film will understand what you're talking about.
Can I say something about Little Old New York specifically? Yeah. Little Old New York is the Marion Davies movie. I've introduced it before, and people often come up to me and say how modern this movie is. Like, they're surprised. They're surprised at how they watch this movie and think that the storyline, the characterizations, the nuances of the lighting, the acting, everything could have been done, you know, last year. And so people who are not familiar with silent films, I think, will be surprised and pleased with how modern these films feel.
One thing I should mention is the Covered Wagon is a Western that we're going to show this afternoon with music by Ben Model. And it's a considered like the first classic Western. It was the early version of Wagon Train, technically. I mean, it's people going across the country and finding a new land, finding a new place to live, and it's a very interesting film. But that's kind of where the Western starts. I mean, that's where you get a lot of the same tropes from various other Westerns. So,
well, I noticed the first movies at 1:30 this afternoon in Topeka at Washburn. Okay, starts out with The Covered Wagon, which says it's an hour and a half long. That seems really long for a movie from 1923, isn't it?
It is actually. They vary. I mean, the Ten Commandments, which we're running on Saturday night, is 2 hours and 16 minutes, I think, in length. Yeah.
A typical film would have been about an hour long. You know, you were still working on what was called the program system, so every show would be a five or six or seven reel film that would run about an hour, and you'd have a comedy short, News Weekly, maybe an animated cartoon or a scenic, but you would have a two-hour program that way. And as a theater owner, you would have a bunch, you know, your shows were 12, 2, 4, 6, 8, and 10. And then a big picture would come in that's an 8-reel or 9, and so that means you have fewer screenings. But the typical film was a little shorter, but there were lots of films that were closer to an hour and a half or longer.
And then it's followed this afternoon by a short. Okay, The Covered Wagon is followed by The Uncovered Wagon, which is followed by two wagons, both covered.
Both covered, yes. those are the short satires that were made on The Covered Wagon after it was made. And strangely enough, they're really pretty good. They're certainly not PC. In The Uncovered Wagon, the pioneers are all using Model Ts to get out into the prairie, and the Indians attack them on motorcycles. Or on bicycles too. I think it is. It's just one of those films. Very hard to describe, but it's a very very interesting 10-minute movie. And then the second one is Will Rogers, and it's again very satirical. Lots of fun going on there. So, yeah.
So those will play, and then there's a dinner break on your own, and then it resumes at 7 o'clock tonight, and it's Harold Lloyd night.
Yes.
So what are some of the movies? I saw the famous picture on the flyer of him holding onto the clock hands.
That's the climax. That's Safety Last. That's the final film of the evening. But prior to that, we are running Miss Fatty's Seaside Lovers. It's a Fatty.
Is he in drag?
Yeah. Yes, he is. Okay. Fatty Arbuckle in drag. With a group of guys around her, and one of the guys is Harold Lloyd. That's just one of his early films. The second one is Luke's Movie Muddle. This stars Harold Lloyd as Luke, kind of a Chaplin knockoff that he tried for a while as a character in films. Then he discovered the glasses character, the all-American boy. The go-getter, and it's symbolized in the film Get Out and Get Under, a short film where the phrase actually means, you know, what you do with your car, you know, you get out and get under to fix something, you know, while you're in traffic, while you're doing something else. But it's a very funny, very good short film, and then we go right into the feature, Safety Last.
One thing that people might find interesting about Harold Lloyd in particular, especially in 1923, is that earlier on in his career, he had an accident on set where he thought it was a prop bomb, but it was a real bomb, and it blew up in his hand. So he acted with a prosthetic glove during this era, and so. In Safety Last, when he's climbing up the building, he's doing it with a prop hand.
Ah, yeah. So it's kind of like the Alec Baldwin thing, but nobody got, you know.
Nobody got killed.
Right.
Wow.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. It's dangerous. How did they shoot that film with him hanging on the clock? Did he really more or less do that?
They did lots of tricks.
There's a lot of tricks.
Back then, of course, you couldn't do a lot of special effects in post-production. So everything you see is what was seen by the camera. So the trick was to trick the camera. And so, you know, he wasn't necessarily right by the edge, but they had a big drop-off in the background. Mm-hmm. And it's an impressive film. When you watch this, you will be a little bit scared of heights, I have to say. But
you're playing for it.
Spoiler alert, yes, I'm playing for it. He does eventually get off the building safely.
They built sets on seven different buildings around Los Angeles. Yes. A guy named John Benson has figured out exactly which buildings they are. For the rest of Lloyd's life, he maintained he was actually hanging off of a building, but it's actually sets that were built. He had tried this in short films prior to making this and gotten it to work, and they knew they could pull it off. But John Benson has a book out with the exact locations and the addresses in which building. But what's really compelling is that because you are aware watching this that it's not, you know, it's not special effects. There is no such thing as CGI or even rear screen at the time. So the stakes are really, really high, and because they made sure to shoot it in a way that you see the streets below on an angle. It is, and between that and the way that it's cut, the way that the tension is built up is, as Rodney will attest, the screams of from the audience of both laughter and terror, it's remarkable.
Okay,
it's quite something for people who are afraid of heights.
He's not just climbing a building, but he's climbing a building, and then the pigeons get involved, and then a mouse runs up his pant leg. You know, and it's just all of this stuff making it more and more ridiculous as he goes up. What goes on? Someone happens to throw a net out of a window, and it's like, okay, when does that happen? But that's the joke, and we're gonna go with it. And so it's this kind of comedy. It reminds me a bit of Mel Brooks, of you start with a joke, and then you keep going more over the top. Anyway, it's well worth seeing.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Plus that iconic image.
It is better to see it in a theater with people than to see it at home on TV, just because you will have the response of the other people in the audience. You know, a silent film screening, as they say, is a collaboration between the filmmakers, the musicians, the architect, and the audience. And all four of those things contribute to what is there. And the architecture, we're not in a vintage movie palace, but we're in a concert hall that has beautiful acoustics and a very nice organ, a beautiful grand piano. So this will be the best way to see this film, and any of these films, is to come see it.
And it goes on. I guess it wraps up Saturday night. There's the special dinner, the cinema dinner, where Laura Gabrielle will be talking about Captain of Her Soul, the Marion Davies book. And then the grand finale is Saturday night, 7:30 after dinner, with the medicine bottle.
This is a D.W. Griffith film made in 1909. It's a short. You know, it's only one reel. It's barely about 10 minutes. And it's one of those films that they restored from paper prints where is it?
Library of Congress.
The Library of Congress. I'm sorry, I have to have my backup memory here. But they basically have gone in and reshot every one of those frames, basically, that are illustrated on paper prints, and they look like $1 million by comparison to the old things we used to watch. So it's a project. It's called the Biograph Project, and the idea behind it is to restore every one of D.W. Griffith's earliest films. I do not know, but I think there's somewhere in the range of 100, 130 or something like that, films that they've been working on over the past year and a half, and that's just a little tiny thing that we're going to run.
Look pretty good?
It looks great.
You'd never seen it before?
Like you'd never seen it before, exactly. And it's a very impressive restoration. So.
Wow, 1909.
1909, yes.
What's it about?
It's actually about a pill bottle that gets switched at a pharmacy, and they feel like they're going to, you know, the whoever the person is who's going to receive this is going to die. Basically, and there's a real urgency to getting the pills, the pill box replaced or retrieved before this happens, and he succeeds, and it does work out. It does have a happy ending, so.
Okay.
Which is not a given for these 1909 films. They would have a race to save someone who's committing suicide, and they'd get there too late, because why not? You know, it's a 10-minute movie. People don't have as much emotion, and it's kind of shocking when you see these things happen in these films. But that was an experimental time in film history.
Right. Yes.
Okay. And the grand finale is on Saturday night, The Ten Commandments.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Cecil B. DeMille. It's a magnificent movie. It's unusual in that there is a two-color Technicolor sequence in it that we will be showing with the print we're going to run. And it has basically the escape from Egypt, you know, with Moses and his people, let my people go. And finally, there is the Red Sea crossing where the waves part. That's all in the Technicolor section of this film. And it amazes me as I look at it that Cecil B. DeMille created about a 50-minute movie, really, of the biblical material in the film, and then it becomes a modern story after that. And we'll have a break, we'll have a little intermission, but basically the rest of the movie is this modern story. It takes place in the 1920s. It compares the commandments with how they are being broken in the modern age. And the fascinating thing is, I look at it and go, well, in 1956, it was all a biblical epic. It was a 3.5 hour biblical epic. He took the same 50 minutes he had before and stretched it out. So it's quite different from the later film.
Ben Modell, have you accompanied that ever, that version of the Ten Commandments?
Yeah, I've definitely accompanied it at some point. Marvin Fall will be accompanying that on the organ, and there'll be percussion as well, won't there?
Yes, yes.
So yeah, I've accompanied the film. It's an interesting, because you think of the Ten Commandments, you expect it to be set entirely in another time, but it's really it's this modern story that goes back and forth with a corrupt building maker, and there's always, that thing with the cement that's been watered down, and oh my gosh, it's going to fall down, and so, but they'll. It's got a wide range of emotions, to accompany. So yeah, I've gotten to do that. I wanted to mention that, one of the things about Marion Davies that people will see is that she was an excellent, not just a good or competent actress. She's very good. One of the things I discovered in scoring a number for films and then for release on home video is that often in these films, and you'll see it in Little Old New York, there are moments where her character, who is often usually driving the story, they'll hold on a loose close-up, and you'll see her think things through, and you can tell what she's thinking. There are a lot of ways that could have been covered with a title. She has to worry about this or something, but it's just it's
acting.
Her acting, and you can really, I don't know who came up with this or thought it, whether it was Marion or the director. I know in the film prior to this, when Knighthood was in Flower, there are several moments where Marion's character has to just think things through, make a decision, and you see that happen in a sustained reaction shot. I mean, was this something that she fought for, Laura? Or
I don't think that particularly was something that she fought for. I think it was a combination of good directing and Marion listening to the director and knowing what to do. She was an extremely talented, not only comedically, because that's kind of where she gets the credit. She gets the credit for her comedy. She was an excellent, gifted comedian, but also for as Ben was talking about, she was a really good dramatic actress as well. And she's one heck of a crier. I have to say that. You'll see it in Little Old New York. As a matter of fact, she has one very intense scene where she's crying, and that's all her.
Mm-hmm.
And in Xander the Great, another movie where she goes through several genres: comedy, drama, western. She can do each of them in she aces them all. She's
amazing.
No, she's fantastic.
Yeah, it's great. Well, Ben Modell.
Yes.
Next, we'll hear
The
Kansas Silent Film Festival Rag by Ben Modell.
Okay, all right.
Nicely done.
That's fantastic.
Very good.
We'll get a recording of that, and you can
yes.
play it.
Oh,
okay.
Oh,
yes. We're, so that's we'll a keeper.
It. Yeah, yeah.
Well, before we go, let's hear another tune rattled off by Rodney Sauer,
okay.
who has played for so many years with the Mont Alto Motion Picture Orchestra. He's from Colorado, and unfortunately, the group couldn't make it this year, but Rodney's here. What have you got for us, Rodney?
I'm going to play a little piece of, we were talking about Harold Lloyd climbing a building. This is a piece I use in Safety Last for that. Towards the beginning, as things are ramping up, it's called Mysterioso Fantastique by Irénée Berger. I thought for a long time Irénée was a woman. It turns out, no, Irénée, with two E's at the end, is a French name, a male name. I finally had to track down a picture of the composer. His mustache kind of cleared it up a little bit, but I also found his death certificate and his wife's name. So back in that day, that pretty much meant that Irénée is a guy. And this is called Mysterioso Fantastique, and it's useful because you can kind of stop wherever you need to in this piece. And of course, this music wasn't written for the film. It's just what I chose for this scene. And I like it because it is so kind of percussive and episodic.
Wonderful. And that was by, what was the last name of Irénée?
Irénée Berger.
Berger, all right.
B-E-R-G-E.
The Mysterioso Fantastique.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He ended up living in New Jersey, and I tried to track down his home, but I think that was torn down.
Oh.
You can sometimes find where these people were living in the 1920 census, and when I go to a new town, I try to figure out if there's something to be seen there. And Gaston Bourque, the composer I used earlier, his brownstone in Boston is still there. You can go look at it. It's a nail parlor now.
That's Rodney Sauer at the piano. Thanks for coming in. We also talked to Ben Modell, pianist-composer, Laura Gabrielle, the author of Captain of Her Soul, The Life of Marion Davies, and Bill Schaefer. Check out the Kansas Silent Film Festival this weekend. Is there a website for information?
Yes, HTTP.
Yeah,
www.kssilentfilmfest.org.
Okay, that's easy it. To remember. KS yep. Silent Film Festival.
But you could always just Google it.
Just Google the whole word. Yeah, Kansas Silent Film Festival. Yeah. There's just one.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Great.
Yeah, you won't miss it.
Well, let's go back across the hall to hear some of the Mont Alto Motion Picture Orchestra. We'll hear Western Allegro, Don Prairie, and my favorite, The Show Off. Mm. I want to thank our broadcast engineers this morning. We've had Jason Sloat and Chuck Smith engineer the show. And also thanks to KPR staffers Jeff Watson and Emily Fisher. I'm Cordelia Brown. This is KPR.